soldiers in blue rallied. Adolin swung his blade in wild swings. There was no room for a proper stance. He had to keep moving, punching through the Parshendi, leading his men toward the western chasm. His father's horse and his own were still safe, carrying some wounded through the back ranks. The Shardbearers didn't dare mount, though. In these close quarters, the Rashadium would be chopped down and the riders dropped. This was the type of battlefield maneuver that would have been impossible without Shardbearers. A rush against superior numbers, many by wounded, exhausted men, they should have been stopped cold and crushed. But Shardbearers could not be stopped so easily. Their armor leaking stormlight, their six-foot blades flashing in wide swaths, Adolin and Dalinar shattered the Parshendi defenses, creating an open rift. Their men, the best trained in the Alethi war camps, knew how to use it. They formed a wedge behind their Shardbearers, prying the Parshendi armies open, using spearmen formations to cut through and keep going forward. Adolin moved at almost a jog. The incline of the hill worked in their favor, giving them better footing, letting them rumble down the slope like charging chulls. The chance to survive, when all had been thought lost, gave the men a surge of energy for one last dash toward freedom. They took enormous casualties. Already Dalinar's force had lost another 1,000 of his 4, probably more, but it didn't matter. The Parshendi fought to kill, but the Alethi, this time, fought to live.
Living heralds above.
Teft was watching Kaladin fight. Just moments ago, the lad had looked near death, skin a dull gray, hands shaking. Now he was a shining whirlwind, a storm wielding a spear. Teft had known many a battlefield, but had never seen anything remotely like this. Kaladin held the ground before the bridge by himself. White stormlight streamed from him like a blazing fire. His speed was incredible, nearly inhuman, and his precision. Each thrust of the spear hit a neck, side, or other unarmored target of Parshendi flesh. It was more than the stormlight. Teft had only a fragmentary recollection of the things his family had tried to teach him, but those memories all agreed. Stormlight did not grant skill. It could not make a man into something he was not. It enhanced it. It strengthened. It invigorated. It perfected. So this wasn't just Stormlight. This was a master of the spear with his capacity enhanced to astonishing levels. The bridgemen gathered around Teft amazed. His wounded arm didn't seem to hurt as much as it should.
He's like a part of the wind itself, pulled down and given life. Not a man at all, a spren.
Sigzil, you ever seen anything like this?
The dark-skinned man shook his head.
Stormfather, what? What is he?
He's our bridge leader.
On the other side of the chasm, Kaladin barely dodged a blow from a Parshendi mace.
And he needs our help. First and second teams, you take the left side. Don't let the Parshendi get around him. Third and fourth teams, you're with me on the right. Rock and Lopin, you be ready to pull back any wounded. The rest of you, wrinkled wall formation. Don't attack, just stay alive and keep them back. And Lopin, toss him a spear that isn't broken!
Dalinar struck down a group of Parshendi swordsmen. He charged over their bodies, running up a short incline and throwing himself in a leap, dropping several feet into the Parshendi below, sweeping out with his blade. His armor was an enormous weight upon his back, but the energy of his struggle kept him going. The Kobold guard, the straggling members who were left, leaped off the incline behind him. They were doomed. Those bridgemen would be dead by now. But Dalinar blessed them for their sacrifice. It might have been meaningless as an end, but it had changed the journey. This was how his soldiers should fall. Not cornered and frightened, but fighting with passion. He would not slide quickly into the dark. No, indeed. He smashed into a group of Parshendi, whirling and hauling his shard blade in a circling sweep, and he burst out onto open stone. He blinked, stunned.
We did it! We cut all the way through!
Just ahead of him, a final group of Parshendi lay between Dalinar and the chasm, but their backs were turned to him.
Why are they...
Then he saw.
The Bridgemen.
The Bridgemen were fighting. Dalinar gaped, lowering Oathbringer with numb arms. That little force of Bridgemen held the bridgehead, fighting desperately against the Parshendi who were trying to force them back. It was the most amazing, most glorious thing Dalinar had ever seen. Adolin broke through the Parshendi to Dalinar's left. The younger man's armor was scratched, cracked, and scored, and his helm had shattered, leaving his head dangerously exposed. But his face was exultant.
Go! Go! Give them support! Stop! Those Bridgemen follower are all dead!
Adolin and the Kobold guard dashed forward. Gallant and Sureblood, Adolin's Reshadium, galloped past, carrying three wounded each. Dalinar hated to have left so many wounded on the slopes, but the codes were clear. In this case, protecting the men he could save was more important. Dalinar turned to strike at the main body of Parshendi to his left, making certain the corridor remained open for his troops. Many of the soldiers scrambled towards safety, though several squads proved their mettle by forming up at the sides to keep fighting, opening the gap wider. Sweat had soaked through the brow rag attached to Dalinar's helm, and drops of it fell, overwhelming his eyebrows and falling into his left eye. He reached to open his visor, then froze. The enemy troops were parting. There, standing among them, was a 7-foot-tall giant of a Parshendi in gleaming silver shard plate. It fit as only plate could, having molded to his large stature. His shard blade was wicked and barbed, like flames frozen into metal. He raised it to Dalinar in a salute.
Now you come!
The shard bearer stepped forward. The other Parshendi backed away.
Why not earlier? Why wait out the entire battle only to attack now? When
Dalinar was about to get away. Apparently, the Parshendi shardbearer had been willing to let his fellows throw themselves at Dalinar when it seemed obvious he would fall. Perhaps they let the regular soldiers try to win shards, as was done in human armies. Now that Dalinar might escape, the potential loss of a plate and blade was too great, and so the shardbearer had been sent to fight him. The shardbearer stepped up. Dalinar raised his blade and fell into stance. The Parshendi stepped forward, swinging. Dalinar dodged back, swinging his blade and slapping the enemy's weapon. The parry shook Dalinar inside his armor. His muscles responded sluggishly. Stormlight still leaked from cracks in his armor, but it was abating. It wouldn't be much longer before the plate stopped responding. Dalinar was once again forced to parry something Windstance wasn't intended to do. His weight-laden muscles were too sluggish to dodge, and his plate was too cracked to risk letting himself get hit. Dalinar recovered quickly and threw himself forward, trying to slam his shoulder into his enemy's chest. The Parshendi was still full of power, however, his plate uncracked. He got out of the way and quite nearly hit Dalinar on the back. Dalinar twisted just in time. Then he turned and leaped onto a small rock formation. Then stepped to a higher ledge and managed to reach the top. The Parshendi followed, as Dalinar had hoped. The precarious footing raised the stakes, which was just fine with him. A single blow could ruin Dalinar. That meant taking risks. As the Parshendi neared the top of the formation, Dalinar attacked, using the advantage of sure of footing and high ground. The Parshendi didn't bother dodging. He took a hit to the helm, which cracked, but gained a chance to swing at Dalinar's legs. Dalinar leaped backward, feeling painfully sluggish. He barely got out of the way and wasn't able to get in a second strike as the Parshendi climbed atop the formation. The Parshendi man made an aggressive thrust. Setting his jaw, Dalinar raised his forearm to block and stepped into the attack. The Parshendi blade connected, shattering the plate, sending a shock up Dalinar's arm. The gauntlet on his fist suddenly felt like a lead weight, but Dalinar kept moving, swinging his blade for his own attack. Not at the Parshendi's armor, but at the stone beneath. Even as the molten shards of Dalinar's forearm plate sprayed in the air, he sheared through the rock shelf under his opponent's feet. the entire section broke free, sending the Shardbearer tumbling backward toward the ground. Dalinar slammed his fist, the one with the broken arm guard, into the ground and released the gauntlet. It unlatched, and he pulled his hand free into the air, sweat making it feel cold. He left the gauntlet. It wouldn't work properly now that the forearm piece was gone, and swung his blade single-handed. He sliced through another chunk of the rock and sent it falling down toward the Shardbearer. Dalinar climbed down, trying to get to the Parshendi while he was still. Unfortunately, Dalinar's right leg was dragging, and when he reached the ground, he walked in a limp. If he took the boot off, he wouldn't be able to hold up the rest of the shard plate. He gritted his teeth, stopping as the Parshendi stood up. He'd been too slow. The Parshendi's armor, though, cracked in several places, was nowhere near as strained as Dalinar's. Impressively, he'd managed to retain his shard blade. He leveled his armored head at Dalinar, eyes hidden behind the slit in the helm. Around them, the Parshendi watched silently, forming a ring, but not interfering. Dalinar raised his blade, holding it in one gauntleted hand and one bare one. The breeze was cold on his clammy, exposed hand. There was no use running.
I fight here!